Vanessa. Thanks for coming. It's nice to have another of these annual meetings, which we're having since, I think 2008 was the first one. It's kind of improvised, and since then it's taking place once a year, scheduled. And it's good to see a group of this size again. So, Alan already volunteered to take notes on the copy document. Dominic is watching IRC. We have at least three remote participants. So let's say hello to Damian, Alex, and Pico. Okay, I think I know most people, but maybe not everyone else knows everyone in the room. So for those who like, you can, well, introduce yourself with one sentence, who you are, what's your relation to Pearl, love, hate.
I work in a job where I have exposure to Pearl and I like it. So also I have one of few packages which I occasionally have with.
Hi, I'm Dom. I mainly look after the Pearl interpreter package with Nico, who's on IRC. Yeah.
I'm Harlan, or H. Lieberman, and I am a Pearl addict.
I'm Max Lippincott, extra one on IRC, ABE on the Nintendo Dog Machines. Coding Pearl since, like, I don't know, 20 years. Worked in a company who did a lot of Pearl stuff and joined the British Pearl group, like, I don't know, I think maybe 2009 at the Config Catalyst. Bought some packages, like Dipsums, into the team, taking them over from Inactive Upstream, Inactive Developers. Yeah, but also doing other stuff inside Debian. But with regards to language love, it's mostly Pearl.
I'm Ilmar, working at the ETH Zurich, like Axel, doing Pearl since certainly more than 20 years, 25 or so. Yeah, something like that. And doing system administration, that's how I got into Pearl. Was a bit disappointed by Pearl was doing, and I'm quite motivated again since the Model Pearl movement made Pearl into a, showed how Pearl could actually be a model language again. And so I'm motivated and I joined the team just this day.
Hi, my name is Lucas Kamashiro, and I contribute with some Pearl models since the beginning of this year, and I'm joining the Pearl team about 2 or 3 months ago. I like Pearl.
You're keeping us busy.
That's good. Should I go on?
Yeah.
I'm Florian, FSFS on IRC. I work at Berlin Freie Universität as a sysadmin and doing some Pearl coding. Well, I was a bit again inactive over the last year or so due to life, but I'm back now, and that feels good.
I'm David Bremner, and these days I mostly am some kind of Git consultant for the Pearl team, and I'm also recently started writing Pearl again because I'm extending Dev Helper. I'm back in remembering how to write Pearl. I don't hate it.
My name is Salvatore. I've been in the group since a couple of years. At day work, I work as well at ETH doing system administration, and there I first got confronted with Pearl. So it was the language we use for our tools.
Hi, I'm Clément Davien from IRC. Pearl is likely the only programming language I know as a sysadmin. And
Linux contributor.
I'm just packaged OpenPGP applet, which interview a few days ago. I joined the Perl team on Sunday. And, here I am.
A second row, if you want to say something, you don't have to, of course.
Not really, I'm just a Perl user.
Hi, I'm Randa. I took care of a few package Perl-related packages outside the Perl team over the time. And was very happy that the Perl group formed, so I could hand them over. Yeah, in my former workplace, I did program a lot in Perl, and I still like it a lot.
Okay, I'm Gregor Herrmann, Gregor, from ISC and Debian, I'm a member of the Perl team since a couple of years, and uploading Perl packages is what I do in my free time, some kind of weird lobby. Okay, so we have two people here who joined the group, which is a good sign, somehow. We're not dying out. Okay, as for the agenda, I wrote some things which came to my mind in this copy document in no specific order. So I've written down the low-hanging fruit sessions which we've had on ISC, sprints, Perl 5.22, DevCamp, status of the team, and well, the question if we want to start some specific projects in the next year. Does anyone have other topics for the agenda which we should mention separately? Okay. Does anyone have any strong preference on the order of the topics, or should we just go down as they are now? Yeah. Okay. So, low-hanging fruit sessions. That's an idea actually from Intri, I think 3 years ago. I think because of the good experiences in Davis, if I remember correctly. So 1 year ago we said we would have a monthly meeting on IRC on the 21st of each month, which is today by the way. We alternated the times, so in 1 month at 17 o'clock UTC and then the next month 22. UTC, and yeah, and if you go down in the copy document, I made some statistics. I mean, statistics is a bit weird. Just look at the report and drew some things. So there was one meeting which we all forgot about. It was the one in June, and for the other meetings, there were between between 2 and 6 people. So for the okay, so that's the amount of participants in the month. Did someone delete the line here? Where's this screen? Okay. Screen redrawing. So what's maybe interesting is that the meetings at 5 p.m. UTC had on average 5 or 5.5 participants. The meetings at 10 p.m. UTC had on average 1.6 or 2.2. So that's the amount of people who were there but didn't say anything, so participants, which shows quite clearly that, the earlier meetings had more participants, probably because all participants and most participants were from Europe. Yeah. And I also looked, okay, how many people participated, how often, but also what we discussed about, so the topics. It's quite funny to see that in 6 of the 10 meetings we talked about sprints in some way, like organizing our apartment in Barcelona. There was work on RC bugs, there was various kind of work on different QA questions, transition general packaging, and one meeting was only under quotation mark socializing, which was also a very nice meeting. Yeah, so the question is, if other people who participated or could not participate have any impressions of these sessions which are worth noting down, and then if we continue and how we continue.
Very good idea. I'd love to see if we continue.
Yeah, and I think the statistics show that we should continue them at always the same time, I guess. I wonder if we should take like something like 18 UTC instead of 17, but mostly because it would be a little bit closer to the previous late date. But that's just an idea, not a feeling. So for most of the Middle European living people, that would be 8 p.m. instead of 7 p.m. But then again, not sure if that's maybe 7 p.m. is fine, and 8 p.m. would be dinner time for some of us, so just an idea. But I think we should focus on always the same time. That's also easier to get into some iCloud file or similar.
Did it matter on which day it was? So we decided every day on 21.
To be honest, I didn't check the weekdays.
I actually like that kind of way, because at least locally, we really have to take care if we add some other regular event locally to not take that weekday where this event is or this event. So I'd say I think most of local events are based on weekdays. So it's like Monday is Linux meetup in Winterthur, Tuesday is Debian meetup, Wednesday is Chaos Computer Club meetup, Thursday and Friday is alternating Lux meetup, so, well, yeah.
So you're saying a bit of that variation is good?
Yeah, variation is good.
Such an international...
Yeah. So everyone has a chance, even if he's booked out every Thursday, or so.
Okay. So I think what we have heard so far is that people want to continue the meetings. I also agree that going back to one time instead of alternating might make things easier. Yeah, I mean, I also can think of going back a bit. I guess the question is what Adam and Nico are saying, because they are one hour to the east of us.
Yeah.
And I don't know how it is for you, Lucas, for example. What would be a good time for you?
This is a great time for me.
So Adam expresses.
17 UTC.
Yeah. 17
for which time?
Oh. Nico says that 22 is too late.
Yeah.
Same
here. So,
David?
I feel like I shouldn't vote because I just didn't really find time in the last year to participate. So, you should decide without any extra constraints.
Okay.
So, Axel proposed 18 UTC?
Mm-hmm.
18 is true in the big meter, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Speaking about iCal files, there is an iCal file which has the dates so far.
Yeah, but there are still enough calendar systems where you can't import them.
Yeah,
and which have similar constraints, heavy constraints. So I didn't manage to put it into either the N900 or the YOLA properly, so I'd be happy about one single time.
YOLA works.
Okay.
Okay, yeah, one single time and I will update this. I can try
I sometimes had the impression that it might help if we are going about this a little bit more seriously in terms of writing an invitation a few days before and then also maybe not really like setting an agenda but making suggestions about things that we should work on. Like, okay, this time let's focus on bugs that we haven't looked at or forwarded and this time let's look at this or that and that. Better, rather than meeting up there, see who's there and what are we going to work on, don't know, maybe. So maybe this would like invite others who would want to learn about things or who also think that some things are important and should be pushed. Like a year and a half ago, I think we had this push on hardening flags, adding hardening flags to all Art Any packages. That worked quite well, I thought. So maybe that's an idea. Yeah.
That works if someone takes care of putting together such a thing. Or if people remember to say update wiki between the two or any two sessions, and with then before the session one would look if there are open questions that people like to address.
I think a reminder mail is necessary. Last year Intri and or me tried to send a reminder, we didn't always manage. So if you put this also down in the note, that I mean. Doesn't have to be me, someone else
volunteers
to set up a
crunch shot. Exactly.
it's one time. That's the point.
Okay, who sets up a crunch
shot? Can we do that as team members on Elliot?
As individuals, but
I can do that.
Yeah, okay. So a week before, and this is also the invitation to think about the agenda, and people then can add ideas for the agenda on the wiki. We have a wiki page, Perl.team/LHF, which is quite empty currently because it only had the dates of the last year, but we can use this for preparing the meetings, I guess. Okay. Good. Next topic. Sprints. So, how did you like Barcelona?
It was very nice. Very nice. Sprint was good too. So I think we spent a good 2 full-length day sessions working on stuff which is in the report, and it felt very productive. Dan agrees. So does Nico. I don't know how it compares with DevCamp, because I've never been to DevCamp. Is it more productive? Differently productive?
Differently.
I say yes, with more productive.
I think most of us at DevCamp were not only doing the Perl Sprint. So the Perl Sprint here was like 5 days, or even 7 days. And I think the topics were much broader and rather dynamically decided on the first day, while we had quite a clear plan what we want to do in Barcelona. I like Barcelona a lot too. It was too short, I think. But then again, well, the sprint here was more.
So I guess the question is, do we want to have more sprints in the future? Is that the main focus of discussion?
Won't always have such a conveniently located depot, so I suppose for some people going to a regional, say European sprint will always be easier than going to wherever DevCon is this year.
I wonder if, for example, usually Perl events would be a nice surrounding for a sprint. So like German Perl workshop, Swiss Perl workshop, yet another Perl conference, wherever. Just as an idea. So
that would kind of mean extending make it an extended trip for people. Either that or try to do work during the conference, which probably wouldn't work.
Right. I mean, the advantage of us, I think, seven people in Barcelona was that possibly there's seven of us in one room.
Yeah.
Not
no distractions.
Not distracted.
Yeah, that was also, I think, different from here.
So I've been running, or sort of running a sprint during DevCon, and I can certainly agree that there's lots of distractions. And, I mean, it's the people were only available during DevCon, so it wasn't really a choice for me, but I think just in terms of me keeping the ball rolling and getting actual work done, I don't think that that's nearly as effective as either a separate sprint or on the other hand, it's great to have a sequence of meetings during, just to keep talking over issues. And so for that kind of thing, if you had a sort of policy that's less hacking and more thinking and decision making, then I think that could work pretty well during DevCon. Just because you have time off to sort of subliminally process things and then you come back.
Alex says that yeah, conferences and sprints have very different goals, and I guess maybe I could add that it's worth keeping both.
Okay, so a sprint during the next year is something we would like to plan, get to somehow. Okay, any rough ideas about locations or about autumn or spring or New Year's Eve or whatever?
I mean, May-ish time seemed to work quite well. I mean, that would work well for me, but sometime not too close to either DevCon, I suppose. Sure. I mean, maybe we should ask people fairly soon what their general thoughts are and try and collect some sort of consensus when people have had a chance to look at their kind of own plans. And I guess we're talking about somewhere in Europe.
Yes. Do we have any bits for the location already?
Is it coming?
By the numbers, it should be in Zurich.
I know room which we can probably use for that. May cost like maybe 100 Swiss francs per day, perhaps. But, well, the Chaos Computer Club and the Linux User Group local ones share a room, which they usually also went to other communities if there is a slot free. So that would be a suitable location. We'd need someone with a key because the outside door is usually locked by default, but there's no place to sleep there locally. So we need some other place to sleep.
Yeah, I mean, I might be able to provide help with venue in Oxford or the UK. My office maybe has super rooms. Alex points out that May's a good time because it's around the time of the Pearl releases. And that worked well actually. We got a lot of good Pearl 5.22 work done.
It's true,
in Barcelona.
Yeah?
Are you sure you're still connected?
No, I just disconnected. I'm trying to.
Okay, so if you want to work on this on the mailing list, then someone should kick this off. Who wants to write the starting name on the mailing list?
Looking at me, should I take that? I can take that.
Okay,
yes.
Cool. Okay, 12:22, it's Dominic.
Can you hold on just one more, please? I'm trying to reconnect to Bobby and it's giving me problems. So I'm behind in note taking. There we go.
Could you click on that?
Did that
URL?
Did I
No.
Can I click?
You need to
yes.
Copy
into the web browser.
Oh, reopen the file and keep the old one open. That serves.
Scroll past the fetch closet.
Yep.
So, shall we carry on?
Yes, yeah, okay.
So I just wrote this transition tracking bug to the release team, which summarizes the state of Perl 5.22. Which can be summarised as mostly there are a lot of trivial bugs in architecture all packages that can be fixed, probably many of them by team members. It wasn't strictly related to 5.22, but the removal of some obsolete MakeMaker implications caused quite a few build failures. We need help with mod Perl because there's no particular movement from upstream to fix that, and that's likely to block the transition altogether. So if anyone feels like taking a stab at it, the bug number is, I think, on that list. It didn't look like a particularly complicated problem to fix for somebody who knew enough about the internals, which I don't, sadly. Otherwise, I think we're just waiting for the GCC transition to finish. So, in terms of the team... Oh yeah, there is another gobby document which is helping to track work on these issues, which is in the team's Perl folder. So that's a good place to note down if you're working on something.
Sorry, Justin, I think back to the mod Perl stuff. I'm not 100% sure, but I think there was already some breakage or regression that manifested for packages Debian at all, and it was actually at the end replaced by some other solutions, which was actually not modular or something like that.
Mm.
So it removal may be a possible option, which you also said there, but it may be worse to consider. I don't know.
I think
just thinking out loud.
I would be very nervous about pushing the removal of mod Perl from Debian at this point. I mean, it's got 10,000 installations.
Okay.
According to PodCon.
It's slightly above average.
So, which is, I mean, it may not be being deployed for new much these days, but yeah, I think it would be bad for Debian.
Okay.
I don't know if anyone else disagrees.
I actually use it.
That's what we care about, isn't
it? Yeah.
Yeah.
Could we be able to look? Yeah. And there are many reverse dependencies, as Nico. I haven't checked how many, but... I think there was one other thing. I mean, There was this libcurl package which we probably need to decide whether we're going to just remove it or work to import the unofficial change, which probably makes it work again with the Perl 5.22.
Is there some helpful other upstream, like with EG libc in the past?
Yes, there is. There is a GitHub repo somewhere, and I forget who did it now. And I think it says this is probably working, but not quite released.
Okay.
So, if someone wants to look at that, that would be a good thing. Oops.
Okay, I guess that's 5.22. It all works out, so fine that we don't have to have long discussions.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Okay, we need to have one, so 2/3 of the course are over, and we have 14 minutes left.
Dev camp, we already mentioned some
impressions from Dev camp and the sprint during Dev camp. So for those of you who haven't been here, we met in the morning at 11:30 after breakfast, discussed what everyone had done and what they planned to do on this day, and then everyone went ahead and worked alone or together with others. So it was like Dev camp and the coordination part. One interesting topic is a topic which we talked about last year in Barcelona. Very fruity. It's called the Dev Cherry.
Yes, Dev Cherry is a tool I discovered Dev camp that basically makes it possible to not use Kilt for managing patches. We are still doing 3.0 Kilt packages, and there's a Debian patches directory with Kilt patches, but basically that directory is managed by DevCherry, and as a packager I can not really forget it, but I don't have to use Kilt for like when upstream does an update and only takes half of my patch or changes things in the vicinity, and then the patch doesn't apply cleanly anymore, and for all of that I don't have to really use Kilt anymore, but I can use Git mechanisms to update the patch. And that feels a lot more smooth and comfortable. So I was, during Dev camp I found out about DevCherry and did a bit of polishing on a few of the scripts around it so that the patches were more beautiful than what they were looking before. And also I uploaded two packages where I transitioned to DevCherry, which are HTML Mason Perl and Net OpenSSH Perl. And I'm planning to do a few more if I find some that are relatively frequently updated so that we can actually get some experience using it and see what the edges might be and how it can be used.
I'm sorry, can I get those names again? HTML Mason Perl and
Net OpenSSH Perl. You should recognize them by the readme.source file which I left there, trying to explain a few bits. But the idea is that actually if you don't want to know about DevCherry, you can actually work with Kilt patches still. It just requires that the next person, when I'm next touching the package, see that you did that and reintegrate those patches into DevCherry.
So one more question occurred to me, which is after watching this year's DGIT talk, are your experimental packages in a shape where uploading with DGIT would work? I'm not sure you would want to, but I think they have this Git work tree matches exactly the source package unpack,
yes,
which I think is all DGIT needs. So if somebody was really fired up about that, and in the next 2 days, I'd be willing to sit down and talk about it, or over the next year, we can investigate this as well. So this might or might not be a benefit, but it's an interesting tool. But that would be nice to at least optional to be able to use.
Yeah, I guess it's way too far to take any decisions or to make any huge revolutionary changes in our workflow, but it's good that you work with it, and now we have David, Nico, and you, three persons who know something about it.
Right.
So, yeah, continue experimenting with it and report at the next sprint. It's probably the way to go.
Agreed.
Okay, anything else from DevCam? Axel has added to?
Yeah, just a second. one thing I planned to do here and did was to move all the Lintian checks we had in the package Perl tools package inside the package Perl Lintian profile, which makes sense for non-team maintained packages too. I moved them over to Lintian proper. They were included as of Lintian 2.5.36. We also optimized a few things with regards to performance. One of these optimizations went amok and currently has false positives on all Perl packages. But Niels plans to do another upload 2.5.37 with that one fixed. It's fixed in Git like for 5 days now. So that should not bother us too long anymore. Those tests are already removed from the package Perl tools package. So there may be a short time where we don't have the proper Lintian checks for currently, but that should be over quite soon. We renamed many of those tags to be more suitable for use outside the Perl community. So they got some Perl dash added in front or so. And, So if we have local overrides in our packages, we might need to rename them too. Actually, Lintian has now support for renaming tags. But that was introduced after I imported the text, so that's not yet in there, but I may be able to fiddle that in.
I think it's not worth it.
Not worth it.
It's only our internal tag, and I think there are hardly any overrides for this experimental tag.
Okay. Well, I know I added some, but I also know how to fix them.
Yeah.
And Lynchian will warn about about overrides not hitting anything anyway.
Okay, cool.
I also run duck over all our team maintained packages, but I actually haven't found time to analyze the log, so the log is online on ppdebian.org. Feel free if you find something in there to fix it. If I find time, I will probably work on these, and but no promises.
Cool. Okay, as a last sentence, I said that I would write the report for DevCamp, and I'm still willing to do this, but after I come home and I've slept for a few hours, and then volunteered to
translate.
To translate it, yeah.
No, that's unkind. You know what?
Yeah.
You are our Justin B. UI?
Maybe.
Okay, we have 6 more minutes. The question of how active is the group, how many members do we have, whatever, comes up every year. Since I forgot how I counted the commits last year, I now put this into a script, which is in our scripts repository. Oh, that doesn't look so good. Still too small. So the main answer is there were 58 people who made at least one commit between 10 minutes ago and a year and 10 minutes ago. It were 57 when I checked 2 hours before, so that's interesting. And it's Jan Wagner, who just added a new package. I think last year we still had 70 something. So yeah, not sure what to make of this. And this is also sorted by who committed, who made how many commits. I mean, it's not about the high score, but the interesting thing is we have, I think, 11 people who made at least 100 commits, and then 3 who made at least 50 or between 50 and 100 commits, and well, then the long tail somewhere starts. So the question is, are we happy with this? Is there anything to worry? If there is a reason to worry, what are we going to do about it? I don't know.
So I'm curious what fraction of the uploads are Gregor these days. Are you still uploading most packages, or are other people helping you?
I think we have some statistics by Andrea still about that. I checked the commits that's there, but he only lists the top 10 of all time, and there are only two guys left in the team for last year. That's, I think, Gregor and I've forgotten. Either Damien or Dominic, probably. Let's see.
But this is about uploaders, headers. I mean,
uploaders package per team. So for 2015, well, that's only half year. Gregor sends out, well, I put the link in Gobby, just a second, so you can, it's team status.
I think the question was, is that the person in the uploaders field or the person signing the changes files?
Yeah, so I'm interested in the two uploads as from DevScripts.
I think what Andrea was looking at were the people in Debian changes.
Yep.
Ah, which is also interesting, but more or less covered under the git commit information.
Totally.
So,
but I think there's no doubt that if Gregor was supposed to disappear, then we would have a problem.
So I considered stealing Gregor's guitar just to make sure that he didn't develop any other hobbies.
Should I put that in as a resolution?
That we should steal Gregor's guitar? No. Anyway, let me put this in a positive way and say thanks, Gregor, again.
Well, if we're in the thanking round, then I would like to thank Lucas especially, because most of the packages I've uploaded in the last weeks were prepared by Lucas.
Right. Yeah, that was,
I think, you really hit the high score of new
surely
packages per week.
And looking at your statistics, he's already on
top 10.
Top 3. And with only being with us for a year or so?
Less than a year.
So
welcome.
Okay.
Each day.
Good, we have 1 minute left. Well, so I guess if something is to be said about this membership thing, then we have to take it to the mailing list. And we talk about documentation for a new company, whatever. Yeah, not now. Is there something for the remaining minute from this list of potential projects at the bottom where someone says, yeah, we should tackle this and I will kick it off at the mailing list?
What's the status with the signature verification stuff? I think that would be very good to have. I'm not sure if CPAN actually makes those signatures available or what signatures we'd be looking for.
So this relates to the discussion, the talk.
Yeah,
which
exactly.
A talk that the archive will perhaps soon support verification, ship and verify detached signatures of tarballs. CPAN style signatures have a signatures file inside, assigned signatures file hashes inside the
dist.
And I think that the signatures may also be separated, may also be distributed separately from that.
But that's not really the U-scan kind of signature.
No, I don't really know if there is any way that we can make that. I guess that would probably be more package Perl tools workflow improvement, if indeed any improvement is needed.
Actually,
is it verified signatures at the moment?
No.
Anywhere?
I think the question is, are there actually the streams signing their packages?
Yeah.
I think they have
some
to sign for uploading, don't they?
Yeah, because I...
How does Paul do authentication?
It's just for username
and
password.
Right.
If, in fact, it's less than that.
Okay, so this looks like an interesting topic. We are 1 minute
yes.
over time. Does someone want to make this his topic?
Yeah, I'd like to talk with DKG about it. Because I think he has the best insight on that topic anyway, so I'd really like to see maybe support for that in USCAN already.
Two final notes from RLC. Nico says, auto package test coverage has improved tremendously. Thank you, everyone.
Yay.
Alex M says, thank you all for being such a great team.
Yay. Yeah. I guess we should stop here before we get kicked out. So, yeah, thanks to this great team, to everyone.
Yeah.
Okay.